Hey guys, wait, welcome back to the channel. It's awesome that you're tuning in, because in this video we are going to take a close look at the XU10 model. So this is a device that I've reviewed some time ago, but this is not the same one, this is a different version. Yep, this device is a quite interesting one, because it does have a very nice price point and it does have a lot of possibilities. And this is a great example of, let's say, what you can actually buy from China that is not cheap and bad anymore. No, they have changed the game completely. So first of all, let's do a quick overview of the specs. So the Mali GU31 is the GPU now. It's a combination of the ROG chip, this thing that we have seen many times before now, but now for a very low price. The ROG chip 3326S is a quad core with a 64-bit Cortex A35 running on 1.6 GHz, having 1 GB of DDR4, having 2660 MHz. So we even have the option to slap in a 512 GB SD card and emulation performance for PlayStation Portable, N64, Nintendo DS, and many different devices systems. So one of the cool features is a 3.5 inch IPS display in the inside, but in a resolution of 640x480. 3000 mAh battery built in that will give you around like 6 all the way up to 8 hours of game time. And you know, if you're going to be looking into the price points, this is such an overall good deal. But how is the quality now, and how is it with the new improved software? This thing comes in all kinds of different colors, even like this GameCube purple one. I just picked up the gray. Kind of boring, but you know, for purpose of review, just wanted to check out how this thing will look. So overall, when you're looking at the display, this thing does have like a tiny black bezel around it, but nothing, let's say, horrible or ugly. So we have the option for two SD cards, which you can just actually show here. Then went for the single SD card configuration. Okay, so what are we getting more inside the package itself, beside the device? It comes with a very long USB-C cable. Okay, that's nice. We're even having a very nice screen protector that didn't implement for you, but you can do yourself, and some wipes. And then, of course, the toilet paper manual with some quick explanation that makes no sense most of the time. And it's kind of positive but also negative. So first of all, if you're going to be loading up everything on the one SD card, if this SD card gets corrupted, you will lose everything. And let's see the brand. Yeah, there are like nameless like brands, and these things are not the best quality. I wish they went for like, say, Samsung or SanDisk, some other maybe better Chinese brands. But when it comes to the configuration, the layout itself, nothing has been changed there. But why did I like this device so much at the first time I've reviewed it, or at least the first generation? The D-pad is absolutely great. I love this. It's similar to the PlayStation 4 controller. And when you're going to be looking at it, and of course, yeah, the touch itself, that was another thing. You have a very nice travel, a very nice feedback, and it was very responsive for fighting games and beat 'em ups and shmups. Select start, and of course the AVXY with the wicked test. And I can tell you, this feels very nice. The buttons are not too small, don't have like a wiggle to it, and they have a very nice travel, and two joysticks for the people who just want to play with the joysticks, and even have the click underneath. At the side, we're finding volume, yeah, the volume control. Yes, I almost said it wrong. The volume control over here. At the back, we're finding the reset and the on and off switch. So turning it on, here will give you the LED indication, also when you're going to be charging it. And the G button. The G is going to be mapped for the menu and a headphone jack out. And what's interesting, that the headphone jack out is actually being on the right side. That is something you don't see very often. At the bottom, nothing. And at the top, finding two USB-C ports. And one thing is one of those, let's say, very cool features that when you're going to be booting it up, you will see how beautiful this display is. I think the camera doesn't even do it justice. And that's one of those key features, and absolutely unbelievable that we've reached the point that we can find these very cheap devices with very good screens in the inside. At the middle of the device, we're finding only one speaker. At first, I was kind of bummed out that it was only one speaker, because normally you're having like an absolutely overall great experience for the audio when you're having two speakers, mostly on the bottom or at the front. But how is it when it comes to, let's say, the display itself and the menu? So what I really love about this device in general is that this thing is very easy to use. I think if you want to pick something up, you don't want to tinker, this can be something of a very interesting option. But first, let's clean up the screen, because I made it a little bit filthy, because this thing is a fingerprint nightmare. It's like a freaking magnet. Oh boy. The same I can say for the back buttons. The back buttons are differently configured. You can just see that they have a different, like say, height. And the nice thing about this is there's going to be like very easy to, let's say, place your fingers in and to use them. And that's one of the things that I find quite pleasant about it. And when you're just pushing it in, you can feel that it has like a very nice, let's say, feedback. But how about the software itself? Because this is one of the newest improvements. The layout is different. Now we do have like this very nice hyperspin wheel and different many devices that we can play, like Sega Saturn and Dreamcast. A lot of stuff that we only seen before on game boxes. But that's kind of cool, so I'm really curious and wondering how overall experience is going to be. We already know that the PlayStation Portable N64 is going to be a hit or miss because that is absolutely a limit for the device of this, like say Calibur. But besides that, I think it's going to be interesting to see. So let's start off with some basic gaming like PC Engine. Going into the menu itself, here we're finding the old school menu, more like the Pandora's box look with a nice screenshot. So here you can have the option to search. And the search is going to be general. So let's say we're going to be searching for something with Street. Here you can just see that we're getting every single system with Street in it. But there is no indication actually what it is when it comes to the platform. So that's quite unfortunate. We also can make a favorite list by pressing the Y. And in this case, we can use the favorite. But so far I see in the favorite over here, the favorite list where we can find all our games. So that's actually how it works. It's quite easy. And I think that's one of the big sides of the positive sides about this. But what you need to take consideration, pressing select start, there's nothing you can do when it comes to the menu or the software. So if you want to start tweaking, no, that is not going to be working at all. Every single time you're going to be booting up a game, it will ask you if you want to start a new game or start an auto save. The quick load, quick save you've made, you also will be shown in here, so you can just very easily start in the game. But for this time, I'm going to be loading up a game itself. So just let's wait a little bit. There we go. Pressing start doesn't work. We have the side button over here, the G button. And then we're going to be finding the save state slot. This control is kind of weird. Normally you're only going to be needing that for the PlayStation. Restart and indeed having the cheats. So it's kind of cool. If you can even implement the cheats if you want to. And that's it. But let's get into the game and let's see how it actually works. Oh boy, the audio quality is quite good with this. And I'm not going to be expecting any problems when it comes to, let's say, the old school stuff. But if you're just searching in handheld to playing these old games, yep, it's absolutely great. Oh crap, but we can also use the joystick or the D-pad. Both have been configured correctly. That was the second time. There we go. But also when it comes to the audio, you can be controlling this fairly easy with the physical buttons. And this is absolutely an overall great, let's say, fun experience. But if you just want to play some old school games, like particularly when it comes to the handheld games, yep, this is going to be a lot of fun with some old school Game Gear games that run absolutely great. However, when you're looking at the menu, there are so many different games to play when it comes to handhelds. It's absolutely ridiculous. Can we spin with Sonic and Tails? Oh yeah. I can still remember a lot of games didn't have that option. I found it so weird. No weird things going on. We did have the slowdowns like with the original system, but this seems to be working just fine. With cheap devices, I've noticed Game Boy Advance is going to be an issue. And I mean, in particular with the X-Series handhelds, but with these NC devices, particularly when it comes to the R35, R36 and the XU10, we have overall great emulation performance. I don't know if it's going to be pixel perfect because the resolution the screen actually uses, but also the measurement is slightly different, I think, recall when it comes to the original Game Boy display. But personally, I don't really mind it of a negative thing. Before we're going to be tuning in the newer generation of devices, think about Sega Saturn, Dreamcast, PlayStation Portable, PlayStation 1. So Homebrew was also enabled on this device with some Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Shredder's Revenge. I think they ported this from the Android, but the main problem with this particular device is that the loading times are so freaking long. to the point you can just grab yourself a cup of coffee or tea before this thing is going to be booted up. So is this like the full experience you want to have? Yeah, I think this is a little bit too soon when it comes to a device like that. We need to have more power to actually enjoy these games. But after like say 3 minutes or so, it finally starts up. I have no idea why this thing is in Spanish. Also weird that I cannot do anything. And I think that has to do because I was starting up the game with the volume button. Yeah, that was a thing. So the configuration is not perfect. So let's give this thing another attempt. Let's boot it up. Let's wait another 3 minutes and don't use the volume control for actually booting it up. Yep. So that was like the spiny things you need to fix or just to remove the game because this is not the experience we want to have. Attempt number two. Okay, so let's press the right button and there we go. So it was a kind of weird, interesting configuration. Can we adjust the volume? Yeah, so we do have the option to adjust the volume. So there's a little bit of a, let's say, weird situation. But okay, now we know that we don't need to do that. But you can just see that every single time, loading time's quite a long time. Now getting to the character selection screen. We don't have the extra characters, this is just the first game itself. Okay, this is a great example. Now we have like a black screen for like forever, it seems to be sometimes. But it's just loading up the game itself. I don't know if this is going to be fully unlocked, because I did notice like the previous game I've noticed on one of those devices that was fully unlocked with every single stage. No, this one also just have one single game unlocked. And I'm guessing from this point it will load up, but it will take a long time. And this is what exactly what I mean. All right, not too shabby. Alright, so let's see where the buttons are. But again, in the game, I don't notice any problems whatsoever, so that's absolutely great. I do wonder what kind of games we can expect on these devices. Maybe some Street of Rage 4, that would be cool. I know there are many like beat-em-ups you can play on Android. It would be a lot of fun to be playing on a device like this. So let's move on to some newer generation like the Sega Dreamcast. And yeah, that is one of those hidden devices, like hidden gem devices in my opinion, with many cool games. But the reason I just wanted to see the intro, you can see in here that it actually stutters. So emulation performance is not going to be perfect. And I'm just going to be honest, Jack, you cannot really expect like superb, like overall emulation performance with such a cheap device like this. It's absolutely a miracle they can actually play this. Well, let's get into some gaming. No, you can just hear that it runs really slow. So another thing I was really wondering, like what happens going to be pressing the G button or the menu. So we don't have a quick load, quick save. It just automatically goes to this menu itself or the Dreamcast menu. So that's a little bit of a downside that not every single of the say devices has an option. So what is kind of cool, so we do have the option to press the G over here, and here we're having all kinds of stuff that we can change out. So let's say you want to have a different emulator, you want the control settings being swapped out. Oh crap, I am completely messing this up. Restore to default. Okay, go back. UI settings, then game collection settings. You can just basically like go into the selection and just go around like messing around, like filtering everything out if you don't want to have anything like say in your list. So say you don't like the Naomi or the Dreamcast, you can just filter that out. And if you're going to be clicking it like I did, you're going to be having the loading screen and waiting to be everything be adjusted. But this device can maybe be the ultimate PlayStation Portable. And the reason why, because first of all, like the resolution of the screen itself. The D-pad is so responsive, I can just really enjoy like some old school games. The one thing they should like stop doing is removing the soundtrack. So if you're going to be putting the game on here, implement it also with the, let's say, full soundtracks. That would be so cool. It will take up a lot of space. But you can make yourself like a dedicated PlayStation emulator. There's no way of upscaling, so that is a little bit of a downside maybe. There we go, we need to collect all of these things, and I think I can go to the exit now. Yep, stage number one. But the weird thing is with PlayStation, we do have an option for like disc control, cheating, and all the other stuff. So we can make a quick load, quick save with this. I do wonder if people really want to play Nintendo DS on this, because, yeah, let's be honest, this is just a very strange way to play. So at this point, I do have the option to switch the screens like that, but there is no way of actually getting it into a certain mode. Wow, that's really the most annoying sound ever. But you can play a lot of old school games, like Bejeweled. I love myself some Bejeweled. And it is playable. If you can switch between the... there we go, that was the button I was searching for. And this way we can just actually play. In particular when you're just needing only one display, this is just going to be fun. But for me, I want to play Nintendo DS games like they intended to be, especially when you don't have only one single screen that you're going to be using. But one of the systems that's going to be a problem is N64. Let's see where the button is. Okay. Oh, there we go. We do need to play with the analog stick, but that's for me not a big issue. Let's see where all the buttons are. There we go. But the overall emulation performance on this is quite good. And yeah, if you want to play more demanding games, they will run like crap. And that is one thing to be sure when it comes to N64. But a lot of launch titles and a lot of games will stutter, but will have an overall great performance. Or first generation games like Diddy Kong Racing, they run just fine. We didn't have perfect, overall emulation performance when it comes to the Sega Dreamcast. So let's go to the counterpart, the Sega Naomi, with some arcade. What I just want to see is like if you're having an overall good experience. We don't see the frames per second, but would not be surprised that some games will have the same issues. But a lot of games are playable, so that is absolutely cool. Okay, so with some certain emulators, we do have like an audio issue that it is very low. But when you're looking at, let's say, the overall intro, this is quite good overall emulation for that amount of money we're going to be paying for, let's say, this device. It's actually like playable. Is it on full speed? No, it feels a little bit slow, but it's quite fascinating to see how they can manage to get this to work to a certain point that it actually be being playable or enjoyable. So one of the things we didn't test before is the D-pad for fighting games. And like I mentioned before, that this is one of the best D-pads, and particularly when it comes to the budget. I think this is just to do of the form factor. It's so comfortable, just the feedback, the way how the buttons feel. This is absolutely amazing. No problem, no handicap. Let's see, I can do a super move. There we go. Oh yeah. A system that don't really benefit from a, let's say, this resolution display is PlayStation Portable. Also, I'm trying to boot up a game, but it takes quite a long time. Here you can see that it's going to be forcing the game with two black bars. It's absolutely cool to see that we can just actually play some PlayStation Portable games. However, I think this is not the best handheld for this, simply because if you're going to be just playing some more demanding games, it's going to be stuttering like crazy. We cannot tinker with the software itself, so far I know. So you're just actually getting what you're going to be seeing over here. So it's absolutely amazing to see how far these handhelds have come, particularly when it comes to these, like say, chipsets like the ROG chip. You can hear the audio, let's say, crackling, stutters. Also, this stage is quite demanding. You can just see that it runs really slow. But this is not to say that this is going to be a super bad overall experience. And the reason why, because we do have a lot of games for PlayStation Portable that are just playable. Think about the minis. Those are just great when it comes to that. The mini games are a lot of fun and you can just play them without any problem whatsoever. And in particular, the basic games. And there are a lot of hidden gems there. For example, the Jetpack Joyride. This is one of those games that can be played just fine. Where I find sometimes these simple games the most fun. The buttons have been marked correctly. That is another good one, because you don't see that very often with these emulator devices. Very responsive. We don't have a touchscreen, because that is how you play these games on your phone. Woohoo! Free spin token. Yeah. Oh, you should know how many times I've bought and played this game. Ah, no bonus. Okay, so enough about the games itself. It's amazing how good it actually works with many systems. But let's try the OTG port. In other words, let's grab ourselves an, let's say, adapter. And let's see if we have like HDMI out. And can we configure this thing like in Gamebox? So with a device like this, we can normally have the OTG port converted to HDMI. It's going to be powering on. So let's see what this will do. Going to be removing the mini HDMI adapter. Let's plug this bad boy in. So far I can see nothing is happening in the LED functionality. It needs to be turning blue, so that doesn't work. So what we actually can do is going to the menu. So it's going to be into the menu itself. There we go. Plug it out. Plug it in the OTG port. Let's see what happens. Nope, nothing seems to be working. So that's a little bit of a downside that we don't have the option for AV out. So what we actually can do is going back into the, let's say, software. So basically turning it on and off and see what happens. Are we going to be doing that? We cannot, let's say, change out anything here. There we go, restart the system. I think that's the most convenient thing. All right, so it's going to be into reset, and let's see if it's going to be resetting into a different, let's say, configuration. But nope. So it's kind of weird, because the OTG port is, let's say, activated with the LED over here. You can see that it will give signal, but I'm guessing you can use it maybe with a controller or so, but not with, let's say, the device itself. Okay, so construction wise this is a very nice build with beautiful inbuilt, let's say, parkers they are using. So we can lift up this piece over here, and yeah, there we can find ourselves the battery. But you know what's kind of interesting? That when you're looking at, let's say, the inside, you would think this is going to be, and let's say, in speaker audio, let's say, output. It's just for, like, say, cooling off the CPU. Ooh, this is do get a little bit hot, so they're using this very nice piece of, let's say, metal or even copper on it, for giving this thing some, let's say, overall, let's say, cooling. There's no active cooling in here, so we're fine with the 3000 milliamp battery. You can just unplug it. So maintenance wise this thing is absolutely great. The same as we're going to be removing this plate over here, we can remove the joysticks, upgrade them, or replace them if needed. So if you need to do some maintenance with this device, I can tell you that it is possible. Construction wise everything, also we can remove the shoulder buttons. If everything, let's say, anything breaks down here, we can replace them. So, like, it's a, let's say, it's recyclable, and we can repair it if you're going to be needing it to do that in the future. For example, the battery dies off, or you need to have, like, if you have any issues, like maybe stick drifting whatsoever. The XU10 is absolutely a crazy retro gaming beast. We do have, like, some limitations, but that just has to do with the money you're paying for it. I've reached the point with these devices that we do have, like, crazy good deals with devices that have, like, overall good performance and overall good quality. But it depends on what you want to play, of course, in the first place. So Sega Saturn, Dreamcast is like pushing this thing to the limit, like PlayStation Portable. But however that, I think it's still a pretty good deal. Wait for the flash sales when it comes to AliExpress, for example. Here you can find some of these, like, XU10 devices for really cheap. Thank you all for watching. It would be great to see you in the next video.